Welcome to the K20 Center's Zoom Into Your Career video series. These online career expos give students a way to explore many interesting careers and learn about their career options from volunteer professionals. Joe Coover is the winner of the International Brotherhood of Magicians Close Up Grand Prix and has been entertaining audiences across the United States and abroad for over 10 years.
My name is Joe, and I'm a magician. And it's kind of an interesting job and career because there's a lot of things, a lot of questions that people have about magicians because there's not very many of us. But what I'm going to be talking about today doesn't just apply to being a magician. If you wanted to be any sort of performer, whether it's music or magic or any sort of thing where you're going to be working events or you're going to be kind of selling your services as a person doing something. So let me kind of go over a little bit of what my day-to-day job is. Believe it or not, most of my job is not performing or practicing magic. I do have to do that, but the majority of my job includes returning emails that people send me requesting quotes and prices for shows, maintaining my website, which includes pictures and videos, some sort of, technological hiccups that happen every once in a while. And then also there's a lot of maintenance that goes into building my show and things like that, kind of more hands-on things. Like I'll need to build some sort of, for instance, I recently built a tiny vest for a monkey puppet. That's something that I had to do, but I usually only have to do that kind of thing one time. I do that once and then I never do it again because I have it. So there's a lot that goes into my job that is very, very much like you need to kind of learn as you go. And it's easy to do a lot of those things now because of the things, learning tools like you have available to you with the internet, how you can access experts like we are now, but also just asking a question on a professional forum and getting some really targeted information back. So a lot of times if I have a question about my website, I'll ask it on a website forum and get an answer within the hour and then be able to fix, everything that I do. So so that's kind of like what I do day to day. But it does come with a lot of perks. I'm often booked to do a show in some really cool places. I have performed in the Bahamas. I've performed all across Europe. I've performed on cruise ships. And I've performed, at the State Fair. I've performed for the big New Year's Eve celebration downtown. I also perform in regular people's living rooms. So there's a lot of variance in what I do when it comes to performing. So if you were wondering, well, what kind of product do I offer? What do I sell people? What I've created is a 45-minute show where I come in, I set up everything. I do a 45-minute show where I involve as many people as I can, and I use all of my theatrical training and my magic training to create that 45-minute experience for them. And then, that's the product that I'm selling. I have different levels because some people can afford more, and some people want something really special, and I might take more time, or I might do things that take more of my time beforehand, and that means it costs more. A 45-minute show is priced not on for how long I perform, but for how long it takes me to prepare that show. For example, if I'm going to be doing a show for a corporate client and they want a custom printed illusion where I have a big giant book on stage and I show that it's empty, and then I spin it around, and their CEO appears inside that book. Now that, and it has their logo on it and everything. Well, that's something that I can do, but it takes a lot of time because I have to have a truck. I have to have people to help me move this big giant book onto a stage. I have to have lighting, you know, and all that. And all that adds up. And so that 45-minute show is going to be more expensive, not because, I mean, it's because of all the pre-work that goes into it. So let's talk actual numbers. So for my show, I do about 50-50. About half of my shows are for kids and families. So, and those shows happen at libraries, at churches, at summer camps, and at birthday parties mainly. But also we do Christmas parties and Easter parties and all sorts of things like that. So that's about half of what I do. And then the other half of what I do is I perform for corporations or companies or, you know, small groups. And so this could be a Christmas party or a corporate party, a grand opening at a store, a fall carnival at like a city, or a 4th of July celebration, or New Year's Eve celebration, or something like that. And while there may be children there at the event, usually in that kind of thing, it's more, I'm performing for a wider audience, you know, at a company party, mainly adults. So I have a family-friendly show, but I try not to be too much like a kiddie magician, if that makes sense. And the reason that I do that isn't necessarily based on what I like to do or don't like to do. It's because that product that I'm building, I want to be able to sell it to the most amount of people. So there's that. Now, my shows range in value depending on how long it takes me to set up. I have a show that I can do out of pocket, you know, just like something really easy. I put on in my pocket. And I can do that show super easy with no setup. I'm not even carrying anything when I walk into the building. And so because it's so easy, that show is only $285. And then I also have a show that includes sawing a woman in half, a magical appearance, and then one person switches places with another person on stage, lighting, sound, music, the whole deal. That show is $2,500. So it's a big range in how much I charge for my shows, but it really depends on how long it takes me to set up the show. Let's see, there's that. I'm trying to think. I've probably talked a little bit about magic, and I'm only going to do one magic trick, but I think it would be fun to do a magic trick so you guys can see. So if you weren't paying attention before, pay attention now. And all you have to do is watch my ring. Can everyone see it? Good. Watch. Watch and don't blink. It happens in 3, 2, 1. There you go. And that's just about 0.5 seconds of my 45-minute show. So there you go. I'm going to check the chat box just to see and make sure that we're all good. Okay, cool. So I think that's about a good enough intro. Would it be time to take questions now, Jamie?
Yes, definitely. All right. So if you have participated before, you know how this part works. We're going to do the question and answer portion. That means that in our chat box, you need to let me know if your school has a question. Hugo, since you guys have several classrooms signed in, instead of telling me the school, if you would let me know again who the teacher is. So like Mr. Lewis's classroom has a question. If you want to go up to the camera and ask your question, if you're feeling outgoing, you can do that. And you're going to do the same thing that we did before where you unmute your mic, ask your question, and then mute yourself back. However, if you are more shy and you have a question that you want to ask, tell your teacher and let him or her type it in the chat box and send it to us. I will give you guys a couple of minutes to think about questions, and we'll wait for you.
All right.
Okay, so Jamie, can I ask the first question?
Yes, you can.
Okay, thanks. So I'll ask this question, and then Joe, you can maybe respond to it while they're thinking. So it sounds like you've got to be really creative and innovative when someone asks you to do some really crazy, you know, illusion. What kind of things could students who may be interested in doing something like that, what should they be studying, or what should they be, like, what kind of hobbies maybe could they take up to get good at doing stuff like that? And then that's part A. And then part B is you're also running a business, right? Because you talked about pricing structures and time invested and all that. What are some things you wish you would have known before you started your business? Because there's a lot of entrepreneurial minded students in the middle school that want to, you know, work for themselves and run their own business. So if you could talk about like what you could have done in middle school and high school to better prepare you to be a magician. And then also how did you go about setting up, you know, your own business?
Perfect. Yes. So some of the things that I find myself doing all the time are graphics editing, video editing, and I would say joke writing, creative writing, because those are kind of elements that I will customize for a client. Now, where do I learn these types of things? Well, video editing and graphics design, you can learn in school, and you can tweak those with on YouTube or on anything. Like if there's something that you think I need to know how to make this black and white, or I need to know how to do this, you know, you've got all that information, and it really doesn't matter that much what software you use as long as you just get used to it. So that's the kind of like nuts and bolts, like hobbies, I would say, like, yeah, art, and then creative writing. When it comes to joke writing, whether you're a stand-up comedian or any kind of performer or anything like that, joke writing and creative writing, like, just get through doing it. And this is a job that you kind of, you have to take some chances every once in a while. You have to try things out. And there's places that I can do that. Whenever I was in school, I was fortunate that I took a lot of speaking and drama. You know, I was on stage, I was doing performances, I was doing talent shows. And so that was the best preparation that I had. The thing that I wish I would have done more is learn a little bit more about the business side. Because I felt like I was really prepared. I was outgoing, I could get out there, I could do stuff, and I could perform. But then someone's like, how much do you charge? I'm like, I don't know. Like, my friend's making, you know, $15 an hour at the Gap. So I guess like it'd be really cool if I made $50 and I'll do it, you know. But what I wasn't understanding in the beginning is that you're not just paying for that hour, you're paying for all the hours that it, and eventually it all evens out and it becomes a little bit in nice ways. But yeah, so learning how to run your business, how to do your taxes, and that kind of stuff. I know it's boring, but it really kind of sets it up really nice. And the cool thing about having a business where you are the product is it's really easy to keep inventory.
Awesome. All right, we have a question from, and they went ahead and typed this question.
Perfect.
What do students, oops, sorry, I lost it. What kind of education?
How much do I make every year?
Well, someone wants to ask you that on the camera. Okay. What kind of education do you need to be a magician?
Okay, so to be a magician, you simply have to learn magic tricks, and I would say do like theatrical training. So you can learn how to speak in front of people in a variety of different ways. You can do it in a public speaking class, you can do it at the Rotary Club or the Toastmasters or any sort of stuff like that. If you're in middle school, taking advantage of the fact that there's somebody at your school that's there to teach you how to do public speaking. So taking those drama classes and taking that, even if you aren't super interested in being Peter Pan in the school play, that's practice for other things, whether you're a magician or a doctor or working in a corporate setting. If you can get up and speak in front of people, you'll get ahead faster, because it's the number one fear in the world is speaking in front of people. Number two is death, and number three is spiders.
All right, we have another question, but the student wants to ask this. This is from, so if you guys would unmute your mic and go ahead and ask your question. Okay. I'll go ahead and read the question, because I'm not sure that they wanted to unmute themselves and ask it. So I'd like to know, how much money do you make a year?
How much money do I make? Yeah. So
how much money does a magician make?
How much money does a magician make? Well, I would say in general, how much do magicians make depends on how much they work. There's a lot of magicians that do magic and they also do something else. Because not a lot of magicians work the hours like 9 to 5, Monday through Friday. So you could work that doing one thing and then do magic on the side. But I do magic full time. And I do some other things on the side. But magic is my main, it's my main moneymaker. It's the main thing that I pay taxes on. It's my main everything. And then the other things that I do are magic related usually. Like, I run magic summer camps, I do magic consulting for other magicians, and I build and sell magic props. So how much do I mean, I think that most magicians that are consistently and you think can make, you know, $50,000 to $100,000 a year on like how aggressive they are in getting out there and marketing themselves. You know, when you're making $500 a show, it's easy to make $20,000, and it's hard, you know. And then if you really push it, then that's when you can get up into 40,000 or above.
All right, another question from you. What are some interesting facts that you've learned about your career?
So I would say that a lot of people think that, and it's an interesting thing, that what I do for a living, a lot of people do as a hobby. And there's not a lot of things that are like that. Like, there's not like hobbyist dentists, right? Like, you're not gonna do that. So there's a difference between learning magic as a hobby and learning magic as your profession, in which is the number one thing is that if you're learning it as a hobby, you learn a lot of tricks, like, because you're mainly doing it to entertain yourself. But whenever I do it I'm doing it as a profession, I learn very few tricks, but I want those tricks to be really good. So I do the same tricks over and over and over every show, and to try and make them better. So that's one interesting thing. And people always ask me to do magic. Whenever I tell them what I do for a living, they like, what do you do? What's your job? And I'm like, I'm a magician. I'm like, do a magic trick. I'm used to it now. But it's kind of funny, because nobody really, you know, if someone's like, oh, what do you do? I'm an accountant. Do my taxes. Or like, whatever. It's something that people kind of, you know, a little bit sometimes expect you to do for free. And I think it's mainly based on that. Some people, they do it as a hobby.
All right. Thank you, guys. You've asked some amazing questions. I think you guys are still on here. If you guys have any questions, please send them in the chat box, or let us know if a student wants to ask them. To buy you guys some more think time before we end the meeting, I'll ask you a question. Are there any schools, say like even universities or training schools, that are dedicated only to magic, to training magicians?
Yes, there are. And there's, so I'll start furthest away. There's universities in China where they train magicians. But China's like a whole different system. You may be familiar with like the Chinese acrobats, you know, And it's a similar thing. It's like that. It's like Chinese acrobats, but it's for magicians. And they, you know, from real little, they train them up to be magicians. And it's not super successful, because I feel like magic has to be something that you have a passion for, to be creative, to innovate, and to let it highlight your personality. And I've heard drilled into you from a little kid, do this, take the ring, slap them together, you know, it doesn't translate as well, and it doesn't come across as entertaining. It works really well with gymnastics. Like you can force a kid to do flips all day. So then there are some universities that are doing, I wouldn't say like training magicians, but they're studying magic and how it works and how it works on your brain. But most of the training that you'll get for the magic specific part is going to be self-driven through books, through videos, and there are mentorships, and there are some, like, there's conventions and academies where you will, like, you'll go off and you'll train for a week, and then you'll be done. Or there's a, and then the last thing I'll say is that most cities have a local magic club, and then now with the internet, a lot of people are learning a lot of their magic specific stuff on the internet. But like I said, a lot of what I do day to day is more how to run a business.
All right, it looks like has a question, or at least they have given us the hands up. So unmute your mic and ask your question.
What level of education do you need after high school for this career?
Yeah. What level would you need? So I would say, I mean, there's no required level of education, but I'll tell you what really helps. What helps is, so I have a degree from the University of Oklahoma, and I got mine in filmmaking so that I can do my video editing and I can do my filming and everything. And that's the training that I got from university. But I also took business courses, and I also took, you know, that sort of thing. So while there's no requirement post high school for your education, there's a lot of benefit in getting training. And I would say the biggest benefit is in theatrical training and in business. So that would be how to run and maintain a business. So the biggest ways I've seen magicians fail is if they just can't handle their money, or if, I mean, for lack of better terms, not very good in front of people.
So if you guys are at your schools, if you're filling out that passport that we brought you, under the degree level, you could mark bachelor's degree. If you were going to get a degree, say, like Joe said, in business, you could get a bachelor's in business. Good question.
To give you an example, I have the most successful magicians that I'm thinking about that have mentored me all have college degrees, and none of their college degrees are necessarily in the same thing. I know one is a lawyer, the other got an acting degree, and then one got a small business degree, and then I got a film degree. So those are all four different degrees. And but what really I would say the focus and what makes people successful isn't you have to be good in front of people, but it's getting your business sense and learning how to run a business and how to manage your time, your website, everything like that.
Cool. Any other questions before we let Joe finish talking? Any other questions? All right. Someone, do you prefer to do kids shows or shows for companies? And that's from.
You know, I used to say that I used to think that I liked doing shows for companies better. And I think that shifted in the last 2 years. as I have focused a lot more on setting up my businesses that relate directly to kids. I have been working with libraries doing their summer reading program, and then also through my summer camps where I teach magic and skills to kids elementary school age from like 7 to 12. And then through that, I have, I think that I've developed more an appreciation of like what kids can understand. I think my show's gotten better because there's a lot of people that they do magic in a way that's very kiddy. You know, like you can imagine that kind of magician who's, you know, kind of a clown. And what I found is the kids get it a lot more now, and or maybe they always have, but so I've actually enjoyed the shows that I've written for kids in the last 3 years more than the shows that I've written for adults. Not that I don't enjoy the ones for adults, but adults sometimes have these preconceived notions of like, of what a magician is and how my show is going to go. And I have to fight against that because they have 50 years of experience thinking magicians might be a little lame. But a kid is maybe more open to thinking like, all right, I'll see what this guy's all about. And then I'm able to get them on my side a lot quicker.
All right, one more question from, go ahead and unmute your mic and ask
a question. Okay, so I am doing this for some of the students here, but two questions that kind of go together. One, why did you get into doing magic? And do you ever get tired of doing it?
Okay, yeah, so number one is I saw a magician whenever I was younger, and I thought like, wow, that guy his life must be crazy. And like, you know, cause I was pretty young. So I'm thinking like, I wonder what his whole life is like, you know, cause I've seen TV shows, where, you know, like cartoons and stuff, and magicians wear their tuxedos around the house when they're cooking breakfast and stuff. And so I get interested in what a magician's life would be. And then, so I went to my public library, and I asked the librarian, can you show me where the books are about magicians? I just wanted to learn more about magicians. And then I found that the books that they had, some of them were about magicians, but most of them were teaching you how to do the magic tricks. And that was exciting because I was young and I thought, you know, you can't tell the secrets. And I was like, does anyone know these books are here? So I started learning all of these tricks. And then, so that's kind of what got me into it. I would say I didn't really decide to go like do it professionally until I was 16. And I got a job doing magic at a restaurant, and I would go table to table doing magic tricks. You know, you may have seen magicians do this. And yeah, so that's kind of how it started with me, and then how I got into doing it professionally. Do I ever get tired of doing magic? Absolutely. I get tired of doing magic all the time. It's my job. And some days I wake up and like, you know, I have a show later on today and I'm a little like, I'm like a little under the weather. Like I'm like taking medicine. I'm like, oh, I mean, I think, but I can't call in sick, you know, like, I mean, unless I'm sick, but like, if I'm just kind of feeling crummy, I don't have vacation days. If I don't show up, I don't get paid. The cool thing about working for yourself is that all of the effort that you put in to your job goes to making your business better. But the opposite is also true, which no one is working for you. No one's working on your behalf. So you have to make everything happen for yourself. And, some days I get up and I check my email and I forgot to email back somebody, and I have no one to blame but myself. I'm the only person. I open and close my business every day. So sometimes it's tiring, just like any other job, I would think. But the rewards, I feel like, for working for yourself outweigh the cons of you know, what I would say is that what I do applies to any sort of like entrepreneurial business because you're going to have to do everything yourself at first. When, you know, if you get big, you can hire somebody to run your website. If you get a little bit bigger, you can hire somebody to drive you around, or like whatever it is, whatever that next step is that gets you more time. But you have to do everything yourself at first, and it can be tiring for sure, but I think it's worth it.